Louis the Brog, Erwin Scrodinger, and Werner Heisenberg were the three heavyweight scientists who contributed to the wave mechanics model. When principal quantum number is 1, we say Keshe, as we can see, KLM. Keshe carries maximum of 2 electrons, Lshe 8, and so on. Now, azimuthal quantum number describes the shape of orbital. Anytime principal quantum number is 1, azimuthal quantum number is 0. You are welcome to chemistry class with Flash Isaac. Today, I shall be taking you through quantum numbers. This is under wave mechanics model. In chemistry, a lot of students do have problem with quantum numbers and electronic configuration. I am here to make sure that I solve that problem. At the end of this class, you should be able to understand quantum numbers, and you should know the different quantum numbers and practical examples and explanations. What do you need? Take a bottle of chilled water, relax, and let us begin the journey. Quantum numbers. This is under the wave mechanics model. And the wave mechanics model is under atomic model or atomic theory. Earlier, I established that according to Dalton, which is in Dalton's atomic theory, it says that all elements are made up of small indivisible particles called atoms. Small indivisible particles called atoms. He also told us that atoms cannot be created or nor destroyed. Atoms cannot be created or destroyed. And Dalton further told us that atoms of the same element are exactly alike and different from atoms of other elements. And he said that when atoms combine, they do so in simple whole number ratio. Dalton's atomic theory faced a lot of failure and setback. For example, this is wrong. Atom is not indivisible. In fact, atom is made up of subatomic particles, which are proton, neutron, and electron. In fact, proton has subparticles. So, Dalton faced a lot of challenges in his theory, and I already explained that in under Dalton's atomic theory. I will share a link to that theory for more explanation. But it is good to note that despite the setbacks of Dalton's atomic theory, he was able to achieve success in explaining the law of conservation of mass, law of definite constant composition, and law of multiple proportion. J.J. Thomson, on the other hand, proposed the plum pudding model or the watermelon model. According to him, the atom is a sphere of positively charged matter, positive charge, inside of which is embedded electron. So you can say, call this, let's say, sphere of positive charge, then inside you have electron. So if you look at that atomic model, at the end, it resembles watermelon when you cut it or the plum pudding. The Rutherford's atomic model, also referred to as the planetary model. Rutherford students, they carried out the alpha particle scattering experiment. From the experiment, Rutherford summarized that the atom is made up of positively charged nucleus and that electrons revolve around the nucleus, just the way planets revolve around the sun. And according to Rutherford, the mass of the atom is concentrated in the nucleus. Rutherford was able to make a lot of sense. Then we move to Bohr's atomic theory. Niels Bohr, electrons travel in a defined circular orbit around the nucleus. So he said that the movement of electron is simply a simple circular form around the nucleus. this was found to be wrong. So the attempt to correct Nebor or to understand the movement, the position, the direction of electrons in the nucleus or in an atom, the wave mechanics model was introduced. And from the wave mechanics atomic model, we're able to look at quantum numbers to describe the movement and the position of electron. The wave mechanics model was proposed, or the three guys who contributed to wave mechanics model were Louis de Broglie, Erwin Schrödinger, Werner Heisenberg. This theory proposed the wave nature of matter, the wave nature of matter. According to the wave mechanics theory, electrons are waves of energy. Just the way they are particles, which implies that electrons, they behave as particles and they behave as wave. As wave, in the sense that electrons are in constant movement. They are moving up and down. They are in a very high speed, to the fact that you can't even say where an electron is at a particular point. Therefore, electrons behave as a wave of energy, wave nature. They move so fast. We cannot define the position of an electron. You can't say that in this atom, this is the nucleus, electron is moving around here, that this electron must be here, or this electron must be here, or this one must be here. No, you can't give the exact position of an electron. There's always an uncertainty. However, you can know a region in the nucleus where electron is likely to be found. So, you look at this nucleus and electron. You say, okay, this particular electron, I cannot say that it is here, but it should be around here. That is what is referred to as orbital. It is simply a region around the nucleus where an electron is likely to be found with a particular energy level. Since we cannot give the position of an electron, or since we cannot tell that this electron must be here, but we know that the electron will be around here. Since the electron is wave of energy, it will be around here. So the region around the nucleus where there is possibility of finding an electron, we know that the electron is not here, it's not a particular place, but know that it will not pass here. Since the energy level of this electron is also energy level, it should be around here. So that probability of finding electron is referred to as orbital. Now look at electron cloud. Electron cloud is the region where an electron is in the nucleus. It's different from orbital. Orbital is a region in the nucleus where there is chance of finding electron. So the full area where the electron is in the nucleus is referred to as electron cloud. Electron cloud. The wave mechanics model let us know that matter is not only particle. Matter can behave as wave. So they are waves of energy. They are hardly in one place. They move so fast and they behave like waves of energy. Ladies and gentlemen, this introduces us to quantum numbers. Now that we know all this, what is quantum numbers? I wrote this out. Quantum numbers are used to describe completely the energy and position of each electron within an atom. To look for the position or where an electron is in an atom, four quantum numbers are employed. The principal quantum number, the azimuthal quantum number, the spin quantum number, and the magnetic quantum number, followed by other rules of arrangement of electrons, like the Pauli's exclusion principle, the Auerbach principle, and even the uncertainty principle. So now let's see the quantum numbers that are used to describe electrons, the four quantum numbers, the principal quantum number, the azimuthal quantum number, the spin quantum number, and the magnetic quantum number. If you've ever drawn something like this, then you put two here, you put one, two here. This means you have idea of electronic configuration or arrangement of electrons in an atom. It simply means you've heard of this first shell is K shell and the second shell is L shell. So all these shall be treated in the next class, arrangement of electrons in an atom, electronic configuration, Pauli's exclusion principle, and so on. But if you're familiar with this, you know that this is regarded as to as K shape, right? This is regarded to as a shape. Let's assume you've not seen this before. When you are given an element, let's say chlorine, that is hydrogen, helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon, sodium, magnesium, aluminium, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, argon, potassium, calcium. That is the first 20 elements. Chlorine is number 17. Now, that number 17 simply means that the atomic number of chlorine is 17. And what is atomic number? Atomic number is the number of proton in the nucleus of an atom. The number of proton is atomic number. Now, since we are dealing with a normal chlorine or a neutral chlorine where we don't have negative charge, the number of proton is the same thing as number of electron. But for ions, we have less electron than proton. So for this neutral chlorine, the atomic number is the same thing as number of electrons. It has 7 electrons. How do we arrange this electron in the atom? We simply say the first share, K share, it carries maximum of 2 electrons. That is the maximum it can carry. The second share is L share. It can carry maximum of 8. So this. And any element with 8 electrons in the outermost share is in the noble gas family because it has completed its configuration. It is stable. Because of this stability, they hardly react. How many remaining? 7, 2, 8, 10. So you see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. You call this share M share. Now, this electron or this chlorine, it needs one electron in the outermost share to complete, which means it will be reactive and it will prefer to receive one. That is not the case here. This is what you are trying to do. This first share you see is K share, right? The second share is L share. And the third share is M share. What are these? These are the principal quantum number. So K share, L share, M share, they refer to as the principal quantum number, which is one way to describe the position of electron. So we already know that any electron in the K share or the first quantum number, first principal quantum number, we have 2 electrons. That means hydrogen and helium, they are likely to be here. So we know that if you are trying to look for hydrogen and helium or find hydrogen and helium around the nucleus, we know the area where they are likely to be. We know the electron cloud, we know the orbitals. So this refers to our share, and that is principal quantum number, K, L, M, N, O, as the case may be. Now, the principal quantum number describes the probable distance of electron from the nucleus. Isn't that so? Yes. For example, let's call this electron 1. And let's call this electron 2. So this electron, they are closer to the nucleus. Now look at this electron here. This one is closer to the nucleus than this guy. You see, this guy is far from the nucleus. Then this guy is closer to the nucleus than this one. So the more the shares, the more electrons are far away from the nucleus. Therefore, if we say that principal quantum number describes the probable distance of electron from the nucleus, or if we say that the principal quantum number describe the size of the orbital or the size of the nucleus, well, is true. Because the more you add the shares, the atom becomes very big, and the more electrons are going far away from the nucleus. And the bigger the size of the atom, the lesser the energy required to remove electrons from the atom. So the lesser the ionization energy. So the first principal quantum share is the ground state. And the principal quantum number is represented with N, you can see. So if N is 1, we say that this is K share. If N is 2, L, M, N, and so on. So anytime you see principal quantum number 2 or N is 2, know that we are talking about L share. Azimuthal quantum number. Azimuthal quantum number describes the shape of the orbitals, which I will show you. Various shape of orbitals later. It gives the number of subshares in a shell. And when N is 2, L is 0 and 1. When N is 3, L is 2. All these are grammar. Let's see application. azimuthal quantum number is represented by n. So n start from 0, 0, 1, 2, 3. Trying to look at principal quantum number and azimuthal quantum number, you see that principal quantum number begins with 1, or principal quantum number starts from 1, 2, 3, 4. Azimuthal quantum number n starts from 0. So azimuthal quantum number is always 1 less than the principal quantum number. If principal quantum number n is 2, for example, azimuthal quantum number, which is n, will be 0 and 1. What does that tell you? This one is 2, this one is 0, 1, it ends at 1. If this one is 3, this one will be 0, 1, 2. How does that change the price of Gary in the market? Look at how it changes the price of Gary in the market. For azimuthal quantum number, when L is 0, 0 stands for S, 1 stands for P, 2 stands for D, and 3 stands for F. These are subshares or energy levels. When you are doing electronic configuration, you see S, P, D, F. Now, when L is 2, the orbital is in the S, subshare is S. When L is 0, rather, is S, which means anytime for this first share, n is 1. When n is equals 1, n will be 0. So for this share, it has only s, which means if you're arranging this, you simply say 1s1 1s2. This 1 represents the principal quantum number. This s1 and s2 represent the subshare. So anytime n is 2, n is 0 and 1, this simply means that any atom or any element which has K and L share, when you are doing the configuration will end in 1, which is P. So it will be 1S1, 2S1, 2P1. And this P, on the other hand, it carries its own ones, P1, P2, P3, P4, P5 to P6, which I will explain later. For now, don't worry, just follow the class. At the end, by the time I start using that example, you understand perfectly. Trust me, I know this part is a little complicated in chemistry, but I'm trying my best. Please, at the end, if you feel I've really tried my best, comment me. So, principal quantum number is this. Azimuthal quantum number gives orbitals, and it gives the number of sub-shares or sub-levels in the shell. So, when principal quantum number is 1, it simply means that the element has only K share, which is this. And in K shell, it can either be hydrogen or helium. So K share simply means the element is hydrogen or helium. And for hydrogen and helium, when n is 1, K share, the azimuthal quantum number n is 0. So 1 corresponds to 0, 2, 1. So 0 is only the s orbital. Which means, arranging this, you have only 1s1, 1s2. 1 and 1 simply means the ground state. 1, K is 1. S1 and S2 simply mean this electron is S1, this one is S2. More to come. Look at magnetic quantum number. Magnetic quantum number gives the number of orbitals, it gives the degree of degeneracy. It gives the degree of degeneracy. When a subshell has more than one orbital, we say that it is a degenerate orbital. And for degree of degeneracy, it is simply 2L plus 1. Which we would see later. The magnetic quantum number gives orientation of the orbital. All these are theory. I will explain to you in real life. Look at something. This is magnetic quantum number, right? It is from minus L to plus L. Look at it. If L is 0, if L is equal to 0, magnetic quantum number is also 0, because you don't have plus 0, you don't have minus 0. When L is equals 1, it simply means when we are talking about the P orbital, when we are in the P orbital, the magnetic quantum number M will be equals minus 1, 0, and 1. So that is simply from minus L to plus L. So if you have minus 1, 0, and 1, this is simply 3 levels. When L is equals 2, M will simply be equals minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, and 2.
That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So M is 5. So when L is 2, M has 5 different levels. Don't worry, very soon you understand everything I'm trying to explain. Then the spin quantum number gives the direction of electron spinning. It tells you how electron is spinning, whether up or down. So if electron is spinning upward, it is plus 1 over 2. If it's spinning down, it is minus 1 over 2. And in general, no two electrons can have the same value for all these physical quantum numbers. So you can not have two electrons or two different electrons having the same value for all these. The same N, the same L, the same ML, the same S is not possible. That is Pauli's exclusion principle. Now, let's take a look at these quantum numbers as a building. Take these quantum numbers to be a building. If they are building, N is equal to the roof. N is the roof, which means take the principal quantum number to be the roof. L, let it be each level. So each level means, let's say story building, the house has 2 levels, 3 levels, 5 levels. That is what L represents. Then let's say this magnetic quantum number, let it be each room. ML is each room. If you agree with that, if N is 1, what happens? What happens to L and what happens to ML? If roof is 1 or if N is 1, what happens to each level? From here, if K is 1 or if the principal quantum number is 1, if we are talking about N to be 1 or the K share, what does it correspond to? It corresponds to S, which is 0. 0 means it does not have any level. It is just a single building, no levels. Therefore, this represents N is equals 1. Yo, so you see, the roof is 1, then the sub level, there's no level. So this is simply S. It has only 1 level. It will get clearer. Now let's take a situation where N is 2. We are talking about principal quantum number be 2. If N is 2, what does that correspond to? That is L share, right? That means we have the L share. And L share is here, the roof, 2. If the roof is 2, how many levels will it have? Building 2, L will simply be 0, 1. That is 2 levels. You see, 1 level, the second level. Now, the first level is 0. 0 is simply S share. And for S share, magnetic quantum number remains, because magnetic quantum number is minus L to plus L, no minus 0, no plus 0. So S remains here. What about for this second one? When azimuthal quantum number is 1, which is the P block, the magnetic quantum number is from minus L to plus L. So from minus 1, 0, and 1, that's 3 levels. And what does ML represent? It means each room. So here has 1 room, here has 3 rooms. So anytime L is 1, you have 3 rooms. Let me explain this so this will make you understand. The principal quantum number is 3. That means the house has 3 roofs. We're taking the roof to be principal quantum number. If the house has 3 roofs, how many levels will this building have? So look at this. Roof N is equal to 3. Each level will be L. L will simply be 0, 1, 2, which means 1 lesser than N. And how many? 1, 2, 3. So it simply has 1, 2, 3. So this 1, 2, 3, they are simply the azimuthal quantum number. So S, P, D. It will end in D. Now, 0, 1, 2, 3. Let's look at the magnetic quantum number. For this 0, what is the magnetic quantum number? It is simply 0, because from minus L to plus L, 0. And 0 is just a single 1. So here we have 1 level. Now, however, for the second one, for this second one, where azimuthal quantum number is 1, we're talking about the P block. And in the P block, what happens to magnetic quantum number? It is simply minus 1, 0, and 1. Minus L to plus L. How many are there in total? 1, 2, 3. So here we have 3 rooms. If for P block, you have 3 rooms. That's why you have 1 room, 2 rooms, and 3 rooms. However, for D is simply here 2 when magnet azimuthal quantum number is 2. So azimuthal quantum number being 2, magnetic quantum number will be -2, -1, 0, 1, 2. That is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It will simply have 5 rooms. You see? So SPD, P1, P2, P3, D, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And for each level, they are divided into 2 electrons, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. So for P, you have maximum of 6 electrons. That's why you have P6. So if here is up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, 5 room simply means 10 electrons. So D will be maximum of 10, D10. So in under electronic configuration, you will learn more. The S orbital is referred to as sharp, and it is spherical. The P orbital is referred to as principal, that is the name, it is dumbbell. D is diffuse, it is double dumbbell, and F is called fundamental, and the shape is complex. Ladies and gentlemen, that is it for quantum numbers. Did you get anything?